Aedh wishes for the cloths of heaven, from The Wind Among the Reeds, by William Butler Yeats, read for librivox.org by Ian King. Had I the heaven's embroidered cloths, enwrought with golden and silver light, the blue and the dim and the dark cloths of night and light and the half-light, I would spread the cloths under your feet. But I, being poor, have only my dreams. I have spread my dreams under your feet. Tread softly, because you tread on my dreams. End of poem. This recording is in the public domain. Be Still, The Hanging Gardens Were a Dream, by Trumbull Stickney, read for LibriVox.org by Ian King. Be still, the hanging gardens were a dream that over Persian roses flew to kiss the curled lashes of Semiramis. Troy never was, nor green Scarmander stream. Provence and Troubadour are merest lies. The glorious hair of Venus was a beam made within Titian's eye. The sunsets seem, the world is very old, and nothing is. Be still, thou foolish thing, thou canst not wake, nor thy tears wedge thy soldered lids apart, but patter in the darkness of thy heart. Thy brain is plagued. Thou art a frighted owl, blind with the light of life thou wouldst not forsake. And error loves and nourishes thy soul. End of poem. This recording is in the public domain.
Bury Me in a Free Land, by Frances Ellen Watkins Harper. Read for LibriVox.org by Chuck Williamson. Make me a grave where'er you will, in a lowly plain or a lofty hill. Make it among earth's humblest graves, but not in a land where men are slaves. I could not rest if around my grave I heard the steps of a trembling slave. His shadow above my silent tomb would make it a place of fearful gloom. I could not rest if I heard the tread of a coffle gang to the shambles led, and the mother's shriek of wild despair rise like a curse on the trembling air. I could not sleep if I saw the lash drinking her blood at each fearful gash. And I saw her babes torn from her breast, like trembling doves from their parent nest. I'd shudder and start if I heard the bay of bloodhounds seizing their human prey, and I heard the captive plead in vain, as they bound afresh his galling chain. If I saw young girls from their mother's arms, bartered and sold for their youthful charms, my eye would flash with a mournful flame, my death-pale cheek grow red with shame. I would sleep, dear friends, where bloated might can rob no man of his dearest right. My rest shall be calm in any grave, where none can call his brother a slave. I ask no monument proud and high to arrest the gaze of the passers-by. All my yearning spirit craves is bury me not in a land of slaves. End of poem. This recording is in the public domain.
Chicago, by Carl Sandburg. Read for LibriVox.org by Winston Tharp. Hog butcher for the world, tool maker, stacker of wheat, player with railroads and the nation's freight hauler, stormy, husky, brawling, city of the big shoulders. They tell me you are wicked, and I believe them, for I have seen your painted women under the gas lamps luring the farm boys. And they tell me you are crooked, and I answer, yes, it is true. I have seen the gunmen kill and go free to kill again. And they tell me you are brutal, and my reply is, on the faces of women and children I have seen the marks of wanton hunger. And having answered so, I turn once more to those who sneer at this my city, and I give them back the sneer, and say to them, come and show me another city with lifted head, singing so proud to be alive and coarse and strong and cunning, flinging magnetic curses amid the toil of piling job on job. Here is a tall, bold slugger set vivid against the little soft cities, fierce as a dog with tongue lapping for action, cunning as a savage pitted against the wilderness, bare-headed, shoveling, wrecking, planning, building, breaking, rebuilding, under the smoke, dust all over his mouth, laughing with white teeth, under the terrible burden of destiny, laughing as a young man laughs, laughing even as an ignorant fighter laughs who has never lost a battle, bragging and laughing that under his wrist is the pulse, and under his ribs the heart of the people, laughing, laughing the stormy, husky, brawling laughter of youth, half-naked, sweating, proud to be hog-butcher, tool-maker, stacker of wheat, player with railroads, and freight-handler to the nation. End of poem. This recording is in the public domain.
Childhood by Richard Aldington. Read for LibriVox.org by Thomas Peter. 1. The bitterness, the misery, the wretchedness of childhood put me out of love with God. I can't believe in God's goodness. I can believe in many avenging gods. Most of all, I believe in gods of bitter dullness, cruel local gods who seared my childhood. 2. I've seen people put a chrysalis in a matchbox, to see, they told me, what sort of moth would come. But when it broke its shell, it slipped and stumbled and fell about its prison, and tried to climb to the light for space to dry its wings. That's how I was. Somebody found my chrysalis and shut it in a matchbox. My shriveled wings were beaten, shed their colors in dusty scales before the box was opened for the moth to fly. And then it was too late, because the beauty a child has, and the beautiful things it learns before its birth, were shed like moth scales for me. 3. I hate that town. I hate the town I lived in when I was little. I hate to think of it. There were always clouds, smoke, rain in that dingy little valley. It rained. It always rained. I think I never saw the sun until I was 9. And then it was too late. Everything's too late after the first 7 years. That long street we lived in was duller than a drain and nearly as dingy. There were the big college and the pseudo-Gothic town hall. There were the sordid provincial shops, the grocers and the shops for women, the shop where I bought transfers, and the piano and gramophone shop where I used to stand staring at the huge, shiny pianos and at the pictures of a white dog looking into a gramophone. How dull and greasy and grey and sordid it was. On wet days, it was always wet. I used to kneel on a chair and look at it from the window. The dirty yellow trams dragged noisily along with a clatter of wheels and bells and a humming of wires overhead. They threw up the filthy rainwater from the hollow lines, and then the water ran back full of brownish foam bubbles. There was nothing else to see. It was all so dull, except a few grey legs under shiny black umbrellas, running along the grey, shiny pavements. Sometimes there was a wagon whose horses made a strange loud hollow sound with their hoofs through the silent rain. And there was a grey museum full of dead birds and dead insects and dead animals and a few relics of the Romans, dead also. There was a seafront, a long asphalt walk with a bleak road beside it, three piers, a row of houses, and a salt, dirty smell from the little harbour. It was like a moth, like one of those grey emperor moths which flutter through the vines at Capri, and that damned little town was my matchbox, against whose sides I beat and beat until my wings were torn and faded and dingy as that damned little town. 4. At school it was just dull as that dull high street. They taught me pothooks. I wanted to be alone, although I was so little. Alone, away from the rain, the dinginess, the dullness, away somewhere else. The town was dull, the front was dull, the high street and the other street were dull. And there was a public park, I remember, and that was damned dull too, with its beds of geraniums no one was allowed to pick, and its clipped lawns you weren't allowed to walk on, and the goldfish pond you mustn't paddle in, and the gate made out of a whale's jawbones, and the swings, which were for board school children, and its gravel paths. And on Sundays they rang the bells, from Baptist and Evangelical and Catholic churches. They had the Salvation Army. I was taken to a high church. The parson's name was Mowbray, which is a good name, but he thinks too much of it. That's what I heard people say. I took a little black book to that cold, grey, damp-smelling church, and I had to sit on a hard bench, wriggle off it to kneel down when they sang psalms, and wriggle off it to kneel down when they prayed. And then there was nothing to do except to play trains with the hymn books. There was nothing to see, nothing to do, nothing to play with, except that in an empty room upstairs there was a large tin box containing reproductions of the Magna Carta, of the Declaration of Independence, and of a letter from Raleigh after the Armada. There were also several packets of stamps, yellow and blue Guatemala parrots, blue stags and red baboons and birds from Sarawak, Indians and men of war from the United States, and the green and red portraits of King Francobollo of Italy. 5. I don't believe in God. I do believe in avenging gods, who plague us for sins we never sinned, but who avenge us. That's why I'll never have a child, never shut up a chrysalis in a matchbox, for the moth to spoil and crush its bright colours, beating its wings against the dingy prison wall. End of poem. This recording is in the public domain.
Circumstance by Alfred Tennyson. Read for LibriVox.org by Newgate Novelist. Two children in two neighbour villages, playing mad pranks along the healthy leas. Two strangers meeting at a festival. Two lovers whispering by an orchard wall. Two lives bound fast in one with golden ease. Two graves grass-green beside a grey church tower, washed with still rains and daisy-blossomed. Two children in one hamlet born and bred. So runs the round of life from hour to hour. End of poem. This recording is in the public domain. A Dirge by Alfred Tennyson. Read for LibriVox.org by Newgate Novelist. Now is done thy long day's work. Fold thy palms across thy breast. Fold thine arms, turn to thy rest. Let them rave. Shadows of the silver birk, sweep the green that folds thy grave. Let them rave. Thee nor carketh care, nor slander. Nothing but the small cold worm fretteth thine enshrouded form. Let them rave. Light and shadow ever wander o'er the green that folds thy grave. Let them rave. Thou wilt not turn upon thy bed. Chaunteth not the brooding bee sweeter tones than calumny? Let them rave. thou wilt never raise thine head from the green that folds thy grave. Let them rave. Crocodiles wept tears for thee. The woodbine and eglatere drip sweeter dews than traitor's tear. Let them rave. Rain makes music in the tree o'er the green that folds thy grave. Let them rave. Round thee blow, self-pleached deep, bramble roses faint and pale, and long purples of the dale. Let them rave. These in every shower creep through the green that folds thy grave. Let them rave. The gold-eyed kingcups fine, the frail bluebell peereth over rare broidery of the purple clover. Let them rave. Kings have no such couch as thine, as the green that folds thy grave. Let them rave. Wild words wander here and there. God's great gift of speech abused makes thy memory confused. But let them rave. The balm cricket carols clear in the green that folds thy grave. Let them rave. End of poem. This recording is in the public domain.
A Dream of Italy by Joaquin Miller. Read for LibriVox.org by Sonia. A Dream of Italy. An allegory introducing May Madden. 1. We two had been parted, God pity us, when the stars were unnamed and when heaven was dim. We two had been parted far back on the rim and the outermost border of heaven's red bars. We two had been parted ere the meeting of man or God had set compass on spaces as yet. We two had been parted ere God had set his finger to spinning the spaces with stars. And now, at the last in the gold and set of the sun of Venice, we two had met. 2. Where the lion of Venice, with brows a frown, with tossed mane tumbled and teeth in air, looks out in his watch over the watery town, with a paw half lifted, with his claws half bare, by the blue Adriatic, in the edge of the sea, I saw her. I knew her, but she knew not me. I had found her at last. Why, I had sailed the Antipodes through, had sought, had hailed all flags, had climbed where the storm clouds curled, and called from the awful arched dome of the world. 3. I saw her one moment, then fell back abashed, and filled full to the throat. Then I turned me once more, so glad to the sea, while the level sun flashed on the far snowy Alps. Her breast, why, her breast was white as twin pillows that allure you to rest. Her sloping limbs moved like to melodies, told as she rose from the sea, and she threw back the gold of her glory of hair, and set face to the shore. I knew her, though we had not met, since the far stars sang to the sun's first set. 4. How long I had sought her! I had hungered, nor ate of any sweet fruits. I had tasted not one of all the fair glories grown under the sun. I had sought only her. Yea, I knew that she had come upon earth and stood waiting for me, somewhere by my way. But the pathways of fate, they had led otherwhere. The round world round, the far north seas and the near profound, had failed me for aye. Now I stood by that sea, while a ship drove by, and all dreamily. 5. I had turned from the lion a time, and when I looked toward the tide and out on the lee of the town where the warm sea tumbled and teemed with beauty, I saw her. I knew her then, the tallest, the fairest fair daughter of man. Oh, Venice stood full in her glory. She gleamed in the splendor of sunset and sensuous sea. Yet I saw but my bride, my affinity, whilst the doves hurried home to the dome of St. Mark, and the brass horses plunged their high manes in the dark. 6. Was it well with my love? Was she true? Was she brave with virtue's own valour? Was she waiting for me? Oh, how fared my love? Had she home? Had she bread? Had she known but the touch of the warm-tempered wave? Was she born upon earth with a crown on her head? Or born like myself, but a dreamer instead? So long it had been, so long. Why, the sea, that wrinkled and surly old-time-tempered slave, had been born, had his revels grown wrinkled and hoar, since I last saw my love on that uttermost shore. 7. Oh, how fared my love! Once I lifted my face, and I shook back my hair, and looked out on the sea. I pressed my hot palms as I stood in my place, and cried, Oh, I come like a king to your side, though all hell intervene. Hist, she may be a bride, a mother at peace with sweet babes on her knee, a babe at her breast, and a spouse at her side. Have I wandered too long, and has destiny set mortal between us? I buried my face in my hands, and I moaned as I stood in my place. 8. 'Twas her year to be young. She was tall, she was fair. Was she pure as the snow on the Alps over there? 'Twas her year to be young. She was fair, she was tall, and I knew she was true as I lifted my face and saw her press down her rich robe to its place, with a hand white and small as a babe's with a doll, and her feet, why, her feet, in the white shining sand, were so small they might nest in my one brawny hand. Then she pushed back her hair with a round hand that shone and flashed in the light with a white starry stone. 9. Then, my love, she was rich, my love, she was fair. Was she pure as the snow on the Alps over there? She was gorgeous with wealth. Thank God she has bread, I said to myself. Then I humbled my head in gratitude. Then I questioned me, where was her palace, her parents? What name did she bear? What mortal on earth came nearest her heart? Who touched the small hand till it thrilled to a smart? 'Twas her day to be young. She was proud, she was fair. Was she pure as the snow on the Alps over there? 10. Now she turned, reached a hand. Then a tall gondolier that had leaned on his oar like a long-lifted spear shot sudden and swift and all silently and drew to her side as she turned from the tide. It was odd, such a thing, and I counted it queer that a princess like this, whether virgin or bride, should abide thus apart and should bathe in that sea, and I shook back my hair, and so unsatisfied. Then I fluttered the doves that were perched close about as I strode up and down in dismay and in doubt. 11. Then she stood in the boat on the borders of night as a goddess might stand on that far wonderland of eternal sweet life which men have named death. I turned to the sea, and I caught at my breath, as she drew from the boat through her white baby hand, her vestment of purple imperial and white. Then the gondola shot, swift, sharp from the shore. There was never the sound of a song or of oar, but the doves hurried home in white clouds to St. Mark, and the lion loomed high over the sea in the dark. 12. Then I cried, quick, follow her! Follow her fast. Come, thrice double fare if you follow her true to her own palace door. There was plashing of oar and rattle of rowlock. I sat leaning low, looking far in the dark, looking out as we sped, with my soul all alert, bending down, leaning low. But only the oath of the men as we passed, when we jostled them sharp, as we sudden shot through the watery town. Then a deep distant roar, the rattle of rowlock, the rush of the oar. 13. Then an oath, then a prayer, then a gust that made rents through the yellow-sailed fissures. Then suddenly came sharp forked fire, then far thunder fell like the great first gun, and then there was a root of ships like the breaking of regiments, and shouts as if hurled from an upper hell. Then tempest, it lifted, it spun us about, then shot us ahead through the hills of the sea, as if a great arrow shot shoreward in wars, then heaven split open till we saw the blown stars. 14. On, through the foam, through the storm, through the town, she was gone. She was lost in the wilderness of palaces lifting their marbles of snow. I stood in my gondola. Up and all down, I pushed through the surge of the salt flood street. Above me, below, it was only the beat of the sea's sad heart. Then I heard below the water rat building, but nothing but that. Not even the seabird screaming distress as she lost her way in that wilderness. 15. I listened all night. I caught at each sound. I clutched and I caught as a man that drowned. Only the sullen low growl of the sea, far out the flood street at the edge of the ships. Only the billow slow licking his lips, like a dog that lay crouching there watching for me, growling and showing white teeth all the night, reaching his neck and as ready to bite. Only the waves with their salt flood tears, fawning white stones of a thousand years. 16. Only the birds in the wilderness, of column and dove and of glittering spire, that thrust to heaven and held the fire of the thunder still. The bird's distress, as he struck his wings in that wilderness, on marbles that speak and thrill and inspire. The night below and the night above, the water-rat building, the startled white dove, the white-winged, dolorous seabird's call, the water-rat building, but that was all. 17. Lo, pushing the darkness from pillar to post, the morning came silent and grey like a ghost, slow up the canal. I leaned from the prow and listened. Not even the bird in distress screaming above through the wilderness, not even the stealthy old water-rat now, only the bell in the fisherman's tower, slow tolling a sea and telling the hour, to kneel to their sweet Santa Barbara, for tawny fishers a sea and prey. 18. My dream, it is ended, the curtain withdrawn. The night that lay hard on the breast of earth, deep and heavy as a horrid nightmare, moves by, and I look to the rosy dawn. I shall leave you here, with a leader fair, one gentle, with faith and fear of her worth. She shall lead you on through that Italy that the gods have loved, and may it be a light-hearted hour that, hand in hand, you wander the warm and the careless love-land. 19. By the windy waters of the Michigan, she invokes the gods. Be it bright or dim, who does his endeavour as best he can, does bravely indeed. The rest is with him. Let a new star dance in the Occident, till it shakes through the gossamer floors of God and shines over Chicago. The Orient is hoar with glories. Let Illini's sod bear glory as well as the gleaming grain, and engines smoking along her plain. Joaquin Miller, Chicago, November 1875. End of poem. This recording is in the public domain.
Elizabeth of Bohemia by Sir Henry Wotton. Read for LibriVox.org by Hatton 43. You meaner beauties of the night that poorly satisfy our eyes, more by your number than your light, you common people of the skies. What are you when the moon shall rise? You curious chanters of the wood that warble forth Dame Nature's lays, thinking your passions understood by your weak accents, what's your praise when Philomel her voice shall raise? You violets that first appear, by your pure purple mantles known, like the proud virgins of the year, as if the spring were all your own, what are you when the rose is blown? So when my mistress shall be seen, in form and beauty of her mind, by virtue first, then choice a queen, tell me, if she were not designed, the eclipse and glory of her kind. End of poem. This recording is in the public domain.
Fatima by Alfred Tennyson. Read for LibriVox.org by Newgate Novelist. Oh, love, love, love! Oh, withering might! Oh, sun, that from thy noonday height shudderest when I strain my sight, throbbing through all thy heat and light! Lo, falling from my constant mind, lo, parched and withered, deaf and blind, I whirl like leaves in roaring wind. Last night I wasted hateful hours below the city's eastern towers. I thirsted for the brooks, the showers. I rolled among the tender flowers. I crushed them on my breast, my mouth. I looked athwart the burning drouth of that long desert to the south. Last night, when someone spoke his name, from my swift blood that went and came, a thousand little shafts of flame were shivered in my narrow frame. O love, O fire! Once he drew, with one long kiss, my whole soul through my lips, as sunlight drinketh dew. Before he mounts the hill, I know he cometh quickly. From below, sweet gales, as from deep gardens, blow before him, striking on my brow. In my dry brain my spirit soon, down deepening from swoon to swoon, faints like a dazzled morning moon. The wind sounds like a silver wire, and from beyond the noon a fire is poured upon the hills, and nigher the skies stoop down in their desire, and, isled in sudden seas of light, my heart, pierced through with fierce delight, bursts into blossom in his sight. My whole soul waiting silently, all naked in a sultry sky, droops blinded with his shining eye. I will possess him, or will die. I will grow round him in his place, grow, live, die looking on his face, die, dying clasped in his embrace. End of poem. This recording is in the public domain.
Fickle as the Wind by George Robert Sims. Read for LibriVox.org by Bruce Kachuk. Beneath the shade of waving boughs, the gallant clasped the maiden's hand and urged her with impassioned vows to fly to some far distant land where every joy their love would bless. The maiden blushed and faltered, yes. The soft breeze sighed around the tree and whispered to the fluttering leaf, "Come, soar, my dainty love, with me beyond the realms of care and grief." And straight, so well his suit he pressed, the leaf lay smiling on his breast. But soon the breeze his arms unwound, for leaves more lovely caught his eye, and on the cold, polluted ground he left his love to weep and sigh. Then men with harsh, unthinking tread passed o'er the leaf and crushed it dead. Two moons within his false embrace the gallant held the trusting maid, then cast her on the world to face the fate of innocence betrayed. Ah, maid and leaf, too late ye find what fickle things are man and wind. End of poem. This recording is in the public domain.
First Fig by Edna St. Vincent Millay. Read for LibriVox.org by Winston Tharp. My candle burns at both ends, it will not last the night. But ah, my foes, and oh, my friends, it gives a lovely light. End of poem. This recording is in the public domain.
Ghost House by Robert Frost. Read for LibriVox.org by Mark Smith. I dwell in a lonely house I know that vanished many a summer ago, and left no trace but the cellar walls, and a cellar in which the daylight falls and the purple-stemmed wild raspberries grow. O'er ruined fences the grapevine shield the woods come back to the mowing field. The orchard tree has grown one copse of new wood, and old where the woodpecker chops. The footpath down to the well is healed. I dwell with a strangely aching heart in that vanished abode there far apart, on that disused and forgotten road that has no dust bath now for the toad. Night comes, the black bats tumble and dart. The whippoorwill is coming to shout, and hush and cluck and flutter about. I hear him begin far enough away, full many a time to say his say, before he arrives to say it out. It is under the small, dim summer star. I know not who these mute folk are who share the unlit place with me. Those stones out under the low-limbed tree doubtless bear names that the mosses mar. They are tireless folk, but slow and sad, though two, close-keeping, are lass and lad, with none among them that ever sings, and yet, in view of how many things, as sweet companions as might be had. End of poem. This recording is in the public domain.
Hope by Emily Bronte. Read for LibriVox.org by Soheilat Harry.
Hope was but a timid friend. She sat without a grated den, watching how my fate would tend, even as selfish-hearted men. She was cruel in her fear, through the bars one dreary day. I looked out to see her there, and she turned her face away. Like a false guard, false watch-keeping, still in strife she whispered peace. She would sing while I was weeping. If I listened, she would cease. False she was and unrelenting, when my last joy strewed the ground, even sorrow repenting, there were sad relics scattered round. Hope, whose whisper would have given balm to all my frenzied pain, stretched her wings and soared to heaven, went and ne'er returned again.
End of the poem. This recording is in public domain.
A Hymn by GK Chesterton, read for LibriVox.org by Hatton 43. O God of earth and altar, bow down and hear our cry. Our earthly rulers falter, our people drift and die. The walls of gold entomb us, the swords of scorn divide. Take not thy thunder from us, but take away our pride. From all that terror teaches, from lies of tongue and pen, from all the easy speeches that comfort cruel men, for sale and profanation of honour and the sword, from sleep and from damnation, deliver us, good Lord. Tie in a living tether the prince and priest and thrall, bind all our lives together, smite us and save us all. In ire and exultation, aflame with faith and free, lift up a living nation, a single sword to thee. End of poem. This recording is in the public domain.
In the Workhouse, Christmas Day, by George Robert Sims. Read for LibriVox.org by Bruce Kachuk. It is Christmas Day in the workhouse, and the cold bare walls are bright with garlands of green and holly, and the place is a pleasant sight. For with clean-washed hands and faces, in a long and hungry line, the paupers sit at the tables, for this is the hour they dine. and the guardians and their ladies, although the wind is east, have come in their furs and wrappers to watch their charges feast, to smile and be condescending, put pudding on pauper plates, to be hosts at the workhouse banquet they've paid for with the rates. Oh, the paupers are meek and lowly with their
thank'ee kindly mums.
So long as they fill their stomachs, what matter whence it comes? But one of the old men mutters and pushes his plate aside. Great God, he cries, but it chokes me, for this is the day she died. The guardians gazed in horror. The master's face went white. Did a pauper refuse their pudding? Could their ears believe aright? Then the ladies clutched their husbands, thinking the man would die, struck by a bolt or something, by the outraged one on high. But the pauper sat for a moment, then rose mid a silence grim, for the others had ceased to chatter and trembled in every limb. He looked at the guardian's ladies, then eyeing their lords, he said, "I eat not the food of villains, whose hands are foul and red, whose victims cry for vengeance from their dank, unhallowed graves." "He's drunk," said the workhouse master, "or else he's mad and raves." "Not drunk or mad," cried the pauper, "but only a hunted beast, who, torn by the hounds and mangled, declines the vulture's feast. I care not a curse for the guardians, and I won't be dragged away. Just let me have the fit out. It's only on Christmas Day that the black past comes to goad me and prey on my burning brain. I'll tell you the rest in a whisper. I swear I won't shout again. Keep your hands off me, curse you. Hear me right out to the end. You came here to see how paupers the season of Christmas spend. You came here to watch us feeding as they watch the captured beast. Hear why a penniless pauper spits on your paltry feast. Do you think I will take your bounty and let you smile and think you're doing a noble action with the parish's meat and drink? Where is my wife, you traitors? The poor old wife you slew? Yes, by the God above us, my Nancy was killed by you. Last winter, my wife lay dying, starved in a filthy den. I had never been to the parish. I came to the parish then. I swallowed my pride in coming, for ere the ruin came, I held up my head as a traitor, and I bore a spotless name. I came to the parish craving bread for a starving wife, bread for the woman who'd loved me through 50 years of life. And what do you think they told me, mocking my awful grief, that the house was open to us, but they wouldn't give out relief? I slunk to the filthy alley. 'Twas a cold, raw Christmas Eve, and the baker's shops were open, tempting a man to thieve. But I clenched my fists together, holding my head awry. So I come to her empty-handed, and mournfully told her why. Then I told her the house was open. She had heard of the ways of that, for her bloodless cheeks went crimson, and up in her rags she sat, crying, "Bide the Christmas here, John. We've never had one apart. I think I can bear the hunger. The other would break my heart." All through that eve I watched her, holding her hand in mine, praying the Lord and weeping, till my lips were salt as brine. I asked her once if she hungered, and as she answered, "No," the moon shone in at the window, set in a wreath of snow. Then the room was bathed in glory, and I saw in my darling's eyes the faraway look of wonder that comes when the spirit flies. And her lips were parched and parted, and her reason came and went, for she raved of our home in Devon, where our happiest years were spent. And the accents long forgotten came back to the tongue once more, for she talked like the country lassie I wooed by the Devon shore. Then she rose to her feet and trembled, and fell on the rags and moaned, and, "Give me a crust, I'm famished, for the love of God," she groaned. I rushed from the room like a madman, and flew to the workhouse gate, crying, "Food for a dying woman," and the answer came, "Too late." They drove me away with curses. Then I fought with a dog in the street, and tore from the mongrel's clutches a crust he was trying to eat. Back through the filthy by-lanes, back through the trampled slush, up to the crazy garret, wrapped in an awful hush. My heart sank down at the threshold, and I paused with a sudden thrill. For there, in the silvery moonlight, my Nancy lay, cold and still. Up to the blackened ceiling the sunken eyes were cast. I knew on those lips all bloodless my name had been the last. She'd called for her absent husband. Oh, God! Had I but known, had called in vain, and in anguish, had died in that den, alone. Yes, there, in a land of plenty, lay a loving woman, dead, cruelly starved and murdered, for a loaf of the parish bread. At yonder gate, last Christmas, I craved for a human life. You, who would feast us paupers, what of my murdered wife? There, get ye gone to your dinners. Don't mind me in the least. Think of the happy paupers eating your Christmas feast. And when you recount their blessings, in your smug, parochial way, say what you did for me, too, only last Christmas Day.
End of poem. This recording is in the public domain.
I See the Fourfold Man by William Blake, 1757 to 1827. Read for LibriVox.org. I see the fourfold man, the humanity in deadly sleep and its fallen emanation, the spectre and its cruel shadow. I see the past, present, and future existing all at once before me. O divine spirit, sustain me on thy wings, that I may awake Albion from his long and cold repose. For Bacon and Newton, sheathed in dismal steel, their terrors hang like iron scourges over Albion. Reasonings like vast serpents enfold around my limbs, bruising my minute articulations. I turn my eyes to the schools and universities of Europe, and there behold the loom of Locke, whose woof rages dire, washed by the water-wheels of Newton. Black the cloth in heavy wreathed folds over every nation. Cruel works of many wheels I view, wheel without wheel, with cogs tyrannic, moving by compulsion each other. Not as those in Eden, which wheel within wheel, in freedom revolve in harmony and peace. End of poem. This recording is in the public domain.
Lines Written on Visiting a Scene in Argyllshire by Thomas Campbell. Read for LibriVox.org by Sonia. Lines Written on Visiting a Scene in Argyllshire. At the silence of twilight's contemplative hour, I have mused in a sorrowful mood on the wind-shaken weeds that embosom the bower where the home of my forefathers stood. All ruined and wild is their roofless abode, and lonely the dark raven's sheltering tree, and travelled by few is the grass-covered road where the hunter of deer and the warrior trode to his hills that encircle the sea. Yet wandering I found on my ruinous walk, by the dial-stone aged and green, one rose of the wilderness left on its stalk to mark where a garden had been. Like a brotherless hermit, the last of its race, all wild in the silence of nature, it drew from each wandering sunbeam a lonely embrace, for the nightweed and thorn overshadowed the place where the flower of my forefathers grew. Sweet bud of the wilderness, emblem of all that remains in this desolate heart, the fabric of bliss to its centre may fall, but patience shall never depart. Though the wilds of enchantment, all vernal and bright, in the days of delusion by fancy combined with the vanishing phantoms of love and delight, abandon my soul like a dream of the night, and leave but a desert behind. Be hushed, my dark spirit, for wisdom condemns when the faint and the feeble deplore. Be strong as the rock of the ocean that stems a thousand wild waves on the shore. Through the perils of chance and the scowl of disdain, may thy front be unaltered, thy courage elate. Yea, even the name I have worshipped in vain shall awake not the sigh of remembrance again. To bear is to conquer our fate. End of poem. This recording is in the public domain.
Loneliness by Trumbull Stickney. Read for LibriVox.org by Ian King. These autumn gardens, russet, grey and brown, the sward with shrivelled foliage strown, the shrubs and trees by weary wings of sunshine overflown, and timid silences. Since first you, darling, called my spirit yours, seem happy, and the gladness pours from day to day, and yesteryear across this year endures, unto next year away. Now in these places where I used to rove, and give the dropping leaves my love, and weep to them, they seem to fall divinely from above, like to a diadem, closing in one with the disheartened flowers. High up, the migrant birds in showers shine in the sky, and all the movement of the natural hours turns into melody. End of poem. This recording is in the public domain.
A Mystery by James Ephraim McGirt, read for LibriVox.org by Thomas Peter. I do not know the ocean's song, or what the brooklets say. At eve I sit and listen long, I cannot learn their lay. But as I linger by the sea, and that sweet song comes unto me, it seems, my love, it sings of thee. I do not know why poppies grow amid the wheat and rye. The lilies bloom as white as snow, I cannot tell you why. But all the flowers of the spring, the bees that hum, the birds that sing, a thought of you they seem to bring. I cannot tell why silvery Mars moves through the heavens at night. I cannot tell you why the stars adorn the vault with light. But what sublimity I see upon the mount, the hill, the lea, it brings, my love, a thought of thee. I do not know what in your eyes that caused my heart to glow, and why my spirit longs and cries, I vow I do not know. But when you first came in my sight, my slumbering soul awoke in light, and since the day I've known no night. End of poem. This recording is in the public domain.
The Philosophers by Friedrich Schiller, 1759 to 1805. Read for LibriVox.org. The Philosophers. Aristotle. Come to the point, my friend. We take the Jena Gazette here down in hell, so we know all that a body may need. First Philosopher. Cogito ergo sum. I think, so have an existence. Is the premise assured? Certainly true is the rest. Pupil. Then if I think, I am, but I can't be eternally thinking, and I have lived for long, guiltless of ever a thought. Second Philosopher. Since existence there is also a super-existence. In that state we float, floundering, every one. Third Philosopher. I say just the reverse. I only have an existence. Everything outside me is but a bubble of air. Fourth Philosopher. I will admit two things exist, a world and a spirit, nothing more, and these really synonymous are. Fifth Philosopher. Of your existence I know, well, not, and not of your spirit. Both I vaguely discern, but they are phantoms alone. Sixth Philosopher. I am I, and establish myself, and if I establish that disestablished I am, there is a negative proved. Pupil. Oh, I observe when a man has no more sensible answer, plump, he makes a plunge into the conscience at once. A point of law. Many a year have I used my nose for the purpose of smelling. Now I desire to know, have I, as user, a right? Pufendorf. Rather an awkward point, but you prove early possession, which is much, so I say, use it again and again. Scruples of conscience. Ever I seek my friend to oblige, and unluckily like it, for then conscience asks, where does the virtue come in? Conclusion. Only one method I see, do what you can to despise them, then you may sulkily yield all that a conscience demands. GG. Man considered alone is a sensible creature accounted, but regard him in bulk, and what a blockhead is he. A trick. Wouldst thou please at a stroke the pious and also the earthly paint a voluptuous scene, throwing the evil one in? Knowledge. Knowledge to one appeals as a goddess indeed, to another knowledge is only a cow, milkable every day. Kant and his interpreters. How one wealthy man can make the indigent easy. When a sovereign builds, carters have plenty to do. End of poem. This recording is in the public domain.
A Quarrel with Love by Nicholas Breton. Read for LibriVox.org by Thomas Peter. Oh, and that I could write a story of love's dealing with affection, how he makes a spirit sorry that is touched with his infection. But he doth so closely wind him in the plates of will ill-pleased, that the heart can never find him till it be too much diseased. 'Tis a subtle kind or spirit of a venom kind of nature, that can, like a coney ferret, creep unawares upon a creature. Never eye that can behold it, though it worketh first by seeing, nor conceit that can unfold it, though in thoughts be all its being. Oh, it maketh old men witty, young men wanton, women idle, while that patience weeps for pity reason bite not nature's bridle. What it is in conjecture, seeking much but nothing finding, like to fancy's architecture, with illusion's reason blinding. Yet can beauty so retain it, in the profit of her service, that she closely can maintain it, from her servant chief on office? In her eye she chiefly breeds it, in her cheeks she chiefly hides it, in her servant's faith she feeds it, while his only heart abides it. End of poem. This recording is in the public domain.
A Set-Off by George Robert Sims. Read for LibriVox.org by Bruce Kachuk. With aching heart beneath my vest, I wandered through the busy strand, and like a patriot felt oppressed by ills that hurt my native land. The knife, I mused, the Tories wield, is keener than the winds of May. Just then a bill these words revealed: asparagus is cheap today. Like one transfixed, I stood and read that notice in a fruit shop hung. Grim sorrow flapped her wings and fled. Again the world was green and young. Let tyrants smirch our fame, I cried, and vote our hard-won wealth away. We yet may stem the rising tide. Asparagus is cheap today. What matters though the foolish swine obey the madcap pig-herd shout, and grunting in unsavory line upturn sweet pastures snout to snout? What matters though our noble knights by such a herd are held at bay? Here's solace for our bitter slights: asparagus is cheap today. For one short moment let us cease to mourn the loss of mighty ships, forget how tax and rate increase, and all that now the nation hips. From dreary paths of shame and guile to verdant fields my footsteps stray. Dame Fortune is not wholly vile. Asparagus is cheap today. End of poem. This recording is in the public domain.
Silver by Walter de la Mare. Read for LibriVox.org by Winston Tharp. Slowly, silently, now the moon walks the night in her silver shoon. This way and that she peers and sees silver fruit upon silver trees. One by one the casements catch her beams beneath the silvery thatch. Couched in his kennel like a log with paws of silver sleeps the dog. From their shadowy coat the white breasts peep of doves in a silver-feathered sleep. A harvest mouse goes scampering by, with silver claws and silver eye. And moveless fish in the water gleam by silver reeds in a silver stream. End of poem. This recording is in the public domain.
That Time of Year Thou Mayest in Me Behold. Sonnet 73 by William Shakespeare. Read for LibriVox.org by Phil Schempf. That time of year thou mayest in me behold, when yellow leaves, or none, or few do hang, upon those boughs which shake against the cold, bare ruined choirs, where late the sweet birds sang. In me thou seest the twilight of such day as after sunset fadeth in the west, which by and by black night doth take away, death's second self, that seals up all in rest. In me thou seest the glowing of such fire that on the ashes of his youth doth lie, as the deathbed whereon it must expire, consumed with that which it was nourished by. This thou perceivest, which makes thy love more strong, to love that well which thou must leave ere long. End of poem. This recording is in the public domain.
The Steam Arm by Anonymous. Read for LibriVox.org by Chuck Williamson. Oh, wonders sure will never cease, while works of art do so increase. No matter whether in war or peace, men can do whatever they please. Read to Rawl, etc. A curious tale I will unfold to all of you, as I was told, about a soldier stout and bold, whose wife, 'tis said, was an arrant scold. Read to Rawl, etc. At Waterloo he lost an arm, which gave him pain and great alarm. But he soon got well and grew quite calm, for a shilling a day was a sort of balm. Read to Rawl, etc. The story goes, on every night, his wife would bang him left and right. So he determined, out of spite, to have an arm, cost what it might. Read to Rawl, etc. He went at once, strange it may seem, to have one made to work by steam. For a ray of hope began to gleam, that force of arms would win her esteem. Read to Rawl, etc. The limb was finished and fixed unto his stump of a soldier, neat and true. You'd have thought it there by nature grew, for it stuck to its place as tight as glue. Read to Rawl, etc. He started home and knocked at the door. His wife her abuse began to pour. He turned a small peg, and before he'd time to think, she fell on the floor. Read to Rawl, etc. With policemen soon his room was filled, but every one he nearly killed, for the soldier's arm had been so drilled that once in action it couldn't be stilled. Read to Rawl, etc. They took him at length before the mayor. His arm kept moving all the while there. The mayor said,
"Shake your fist if you dare,"
when the steam arm knocked him out of the chair. Read to Rawl, etc. This raised in court a bit of a clamor, the arm going like an auctioneer's hammer. It fell in weight like a pavior's rammer, and many with fear began to stammer. Read to Rawl, etc. He was locked in a cell for doing harm, to satisfy those who still had a qualm, when all at once they hear an alarm. Down fell the walls, and out popped the arm. Read to Rawl, etc. He soon escaped and reached his door, and knocked by steam raps half a score. But as the arm in power grew more and more, bricks, mortar, and wood soon strewed the floor. Read to Rawl, etc. With eagerness he stepped each stair. Popped into the room, his wife was there. "Oh, come to my arms," he said, "my dear," when his steamer smashed the crockery ware. Re to roll, etc. He left his house at length outright, and wanders now just like a sprite. For he can't get sleep either day or night, and his arm keeps moving with too hoarse might. Re to roll, etc. End of poem. This recording is in the public domain.
To a Young Friend About to Take Up Philosophy by Friedrich Schiller, 1759-1805. Read for LibriVox.org. Many a task in his youth the Grecian had to accomplish ere he a coveted home could in Eleusis attain. Art thou ready thyself to approach that holy of holies, where her wondrous stores Pallas Athene preserves? Knowest thou all that awaits thee there, how dear is the bargain, which at a cost defined purchases what is unknown? Hast thou vigor enough that hardest battle to venture, where the reflecting mind, heart, and the conscience oppose? Hast thou courage to face fell doubt's irresistible demon, and like a man to meet foes who do battle within? Hast thou an innocent heart and an eye sufficiently healthy, trickery to detect garbed in the semblance of truth? Then, and thou be not sure of the guide in thine intimate bosom, fly from the edge in time, fly from the yawning abyss. Many who seek for light plunge headlong into the darkness, but a child can walk safe in the glimmer of eve. End of poem. This recording is in the public domain.
When Father Spanked Me by John Kendrick Banks. Read for LibriVox.org by Sonya. When Father Spanked Me. My father larruped me, and yet I could but note his eyes were wet. When lying there across his knee, I got what he had had for me, it seemed to fill him with regret. "It hurt me worse than you," he said, when later on I went to bed, and I, the truth would not be hid, replied, "I'm glad it did." End of poem. This recording is in the public domain.